It's been brought to my attention that this channel is called Gwen Pink, but I haven't made anything pink yet. Let's fix that. And of course, when you're thinking of pink, you think of Game of Thrones.
What?
Just me? Yeah, there's nothing in this. Game of Thrones is one of my favorite shows, and probably my very favorite as far as costuming goes. Just about every pink costume in the show is stunning. Sansa Stark wears some gorgeous pink gowns. So does Cersei Lannister, so does Marcella Baratheon. But I'm gonna make this dress, which Shae wears. It is probably the simplest costume that you can recreate from Game of Thrones. There are 14 seams in the entire thing. They're all straight lines, 7 of them are unnecessary, and for so many reasons, I love this dress. I hope you don't mind, but I'm about to use a lot of words to tell you why. I'm talking about some strong, in this essay I will vibes, so get ready. I don't know if I technically need to, but I want to give you a couple disclaimers. One, I'm not a costuming expert. I did take one costume design class in college. All I really remember is having to make character design squiggles as part of the mood board for each project. I think this one would get me a... I have no idea, because I never understood the rubric. All I knew is I wasn't supposed to put actual shapes on it, because I got a D on this one. And two, if you haven't seen Game of Thrones, I'm not going to tell you who ends up on the throne or anything, but I am going to spoil a lot of things, particularly in season 1 and season 4.
In my usual Chaos Gremlin fashion, I had no pattern, just 12 buckets of confidence and 8 yards of fabric. I thought I should start with a couple measurements. First, a very loose neckline. If it seems too big, it's probably right, but I'll add an inch or two anyway. Then the distance between... what do you call those little dips under your collarbone? Then the distance from my collarbone around my side and all the way to the small of my back, which I have never needed before in my life. My natural waist, comfortably, of course, and the distance from my collarbone to the floor. Now to drape on my lovely body double, because sticking pins in myself is no fun at all, and despite what the rest of this project would lead you to believe, human beings and straight lines don't go together. With that first measurement, I cut 3 lengths of cotton cord and started pinning them around the neck. I used 3 because 1 looked too thin, 5 looked too thick, and 3 looked just right. We call this the Goldilocks method. Note, I didn't pin it in a full circle, but left 2 loops at the ends. Then I sewed up and down through all 3 lines to secure them together. In my head, a good costume does at least 2 of 3 things. It builds character, it builds a world, or it builds a brand. Brand can be the most fun sometimes, because I think we get attached to those costumes, like Lord of the Rings, or Disney princesses, or Bridgerton. You look at them and they have, you know, the vibe. You know instantly where they're from and you're going to remember them for a long time. Game of Thrones definitely has costumes like that. I'm not sure Shae's dress is one of them, but it's recognizable to me, so I'm gonna give it a 0.5 and you can't stop me.
No, no, don't nudge the camera. No, hold on its own, but only a little, because there's actually me. There's nothing under. Look, look, look. See?
Once I finished the collar piece, it was time to cut my fabric. I'm using gold brocade for the front panel.
Still nothing under it.
I only needed a thin piece as wide as my collarbone dip to dip, plus an inch or two for seam allowance, but I wanted it to be all in one piece, and it had to be as long as I was, and it would be cool if the pattern faced the right way, so... Oh no, I had to buy so much extra of this gorgeous gold brocade. Whatever will I do? I'll have to make something else pretty. I also got 6 yards of pink, thin, floaty fabric. I chose both it and the brocade, at least partly for how thin it is, because this dress absolutely depends on gathering down a lot. Like a lot. In a very delicate way. It has to be pretty darn thin. I cut a 10-inch strip off of one edge, put that strip carefully to the side, while also folding it up so small it could easily get lost in a pocket dimension before I needed to use it later. No idea why I did that. And then the rest of it was 100% ready to sew onto the center panel, because this whole dress is a rectangle. The fact that it's a rectangle is about 98% of why I wanted to make this dress. Like 70% of that was just because I wanted to make sure that I was right about it being a giant rectangle, and 28% because I think that construction is just so pancake flipping cool. Game of Thrones costume designer Michelle Clapton seems to think it's pretty cool too, because she actually does this with several of the costumes, just has big rectangles draped in really gorgeous ways. Kind of like how I used to play dress up with bedsheets, but I love what the simplicity does to build this world. Oops, getting a little ahead of myself. Before I pinned the main section of the dress to the center panel, I did fold both edges to the inside by about 1 foot, just because, as previously mentioned, this fabric is thin, with 2 ends. And I wanted a little more coverage in the front, but then I pinned and sewed it to either side of the brocade. Anyway, this style of dress is worn by several characters. Shae, Roz, some of Roz's co-workers, any number of Cersei Lannister's handmaidens, though they tended to disguise the dress with the spectacular decision to wear a cape every day. I 100% approve of capes for daily wear. And one other character, who I'm gonna talk about later, for no suspicious reasons. Everyone I've mentioned lives in King's Landing, the capital of Westeros, and while none of them have a family name of their own, they're pretty close to powerful families. Shae spends 3 seasons hiding out as a servant to Sansa Stark. You know, just the future queen of Westeros. Sort of. Roz is, for the sake of potential YouTube censorship, an entertainer for the rich and powerful. And of course, Cersei's handmaidens are servants to the current queen of Westeros. I don't know how to tell you how much I love this as a look for servants to the rich and powerful. We'll call it bougie light, because they are bougie. 6 yards of fabric, which is just so much more fabric than you need, all dyed in beautiful pinks and yellows and greens. The front panels are embroidered or jacquard or something fancy, and there are tassels and metalwork and more embroidery and just so many decorative elements. You know, just not as much as all of this. And Shae's dress is just so easy to make. Like, let's go back to sewing for a second. Once my dress was put together into what looks like a giant's tube top, I started about a foot away from the center panel. That's 12 inches foot, not your foot, but that could work too. And marked out twice the length of my collarbone to lower back measurement. This is the side of my dress. I folded the section in half, cut a pie wedge at the top. That looks like it would be a really big pie. But this was just to make sure that the sides laid a little flatter instead of doing a weird bunching thing. I cut it out of both sides of the dress, then on just those side sections, I pinned the top edge down by the skinniest quarter inch I could manage. And cue a visit from my resident mountain goat, aka Mr. Meows.
You can't get in it yet. It's not bed sheets.
I know the camera wasn't in the best spot to see this, but take it from me, I have become his own personal Mount Everest. Why does he climb? Just because I'm there. Obligingly, he followed me up to my sewing machine. I started on the long, very straight, and very easy seams to sew down the top edges of the sides, and he practiced his mountain climbing some more. I almost wish he had stayed on my shoulders, because then he would have been mostly out of my way. I sewed that top edge just as I had pinned it, then folded it over one more time and sewed that down as well for a nice finished edge.
Oh, come on. Wanna walk on my sewing machine? Walk on my computer? Walk on anything that you can possibly walk on? Show your butt to the camera? Why? Why you do this?
Sorry about that. Next, I marked a line about a hand's width down from the top on both the back of the dress and the front. I folded the top of the fabric down to meet that line and pinned it to make a deliberately large tunnel for the collar piece, all the way down the back and the front. And then I sewed it in place. I grabbed the collar piece, hooked a safety pin through one loop, and threaded it through the tunnel like a little sneaky snake, which would have been so much easier if I had just sat down, but for some reason I decided to hold all 6 yards of it in the air like gravity wasn't a thing. Gravity is very, very much a thing. Why did I do that? Then I had a dress, mostly. It was missing a belt and the hem still needed to be evened out, but like, it's a dress. I cut about 3 inches away from the bottom edge just to make that whole dress match the collarbone to the floor measurement I took earlier and sewed the hem just like I sewed the top edges of the sides. Easy. I can't emphasize that enough except to point out again how every seam is a straight line. Every piece is a rectangle. It's not hard to cut out. It's not hard to sew together. Measurements don't even matter very much. This is a brilliant project for a beginning sewist because it's just really hard to get wrong. And an expert craftsperson could execute it in literal days, even if they were sewing by hand. It's so easy to imagine this being handed off to an apprentice to practice on. Easy to imagine that the most expensive parts of it, like the metalwork or the center panels, could be leftovers or rejects from more expensive gowns. And the only thing that makes it more perfect for a serving or middle class is the fact that you can put it on by yourself in 30 seconds or less.
Meow. Meow.
What? Why are you doing that? He's meow. Being good right now.
Meow.
You're being a cat.
I wonder where he is right now.
Where is he?
There he is!
Ooh. Oh, now he's
fine.
Example. For the belt, I used this light cotton canvas. I spent a little while pulling at the side threads to find the straight grain because I wanted the belt to be as strong as possible. Did end a little differently than I expected. It looks very wrong, but I promise it's right. But I cut and stacked 4 layers of the canvas on top of each other and wrapped it in the little bit of pink fabric that I lost in that pocket dimension earlier. Before I move on from world building, I really do want to wrap back around to that other person that wears this dress. Because it's Daenerys Targaryen. You know, Mother of Dragons, Daenerys Targaryen. We get introduced to her in this dress. She's actually the first person we ever see wearing this dress. And she's the only one that doesn't live in King's Landing. Michelle Clapton says that she imagined that Dany's older brother, Viserys, would have commissioned this dress for her based on his memories of King's Landing, from when their family used to, you know, rule it. Which I find very interesting. Because Viserys is extremely image conscious, hell-bent on being recognized in his proper role as the King of Westeros, the Andals, and pretty much everything he can get his hands on. So the idea of him going out of his way to dress his little sister, a princess in his mind, in the uniform of handmaidens, servants, and tradeswomen, I have some questions. Maybe he's just that nostalgic for the home that he barely knew. Maybe he's that wrong about what his home actually looked like. Or maybe, during Targaryen rule, this dress was for high-born ladies. Maybe when the Baratheons and the Lannisters took over, brought in different monarchy, different laws, different fashions, they thought it would be really funny to start dressing their servants like the old princesses. A marvelous and fashionable middle finger to the deposed. Wait, do you think I have enough fins here? Conjecture. All conjecture. And I know it'll get entirely disproved when Game of Thrones prequel, The House of the Dragon, comes out later this year and this dress is nowhere in sight, but I really like the idea. Once the body of the belt was finished, I decided not to hand embroider the entire thing because, well, I don't really know why not, because that sounds like something I would do. But I did have this flower trim that I liked, and I just decided to cut a matching length and hand stitch it down while watching TV, sort of in the dark, which definitely sounds like something I would do more than once in this project. I probably could have gotten away with it if I hadn't done it more than once. And don't mind the pink blobby monster watching me. He's just a good segue. Speaking of pink, I think it's about time I talked about this dress and Shae. There aren't a lot of named characters that wear pink. It's mostly the ones I've talked about already. Shae, Cersei Lannister, who wears it as she shifts from pastel colors to loud, in-your-face Lannister red. Cersei's daughter, Marcella Baratheon, and don't tell anyone, but she doesn't actually have any Baratheon blood. It's 100% Lannister. And Sansa Stark, who at least for a little while is set to marry Cersei's son, Joffrey. He's not a Baratheon either. Sansa actually has one of my favorite color stories because she starts out in gray blues like her mother and her sister, gets engaged to Joffrey, starts wearing purples, which is what you get when you mix Lannister red and Stark blue. She switches to pink when she's desperate to show her devotion to Joffrey and Cersei, and then back to purple when her engagement is called off. But she really can't go back to blue because she's still being held hostage by Lannisters. Pink feels kind of like a Lannister color, but especially like a Lannister secret color. Shae both serves Sansa Stark and is secretly attached to Tyrion, you guessed it, Lannister. It makes perfect sense that she's dressed in almost Lannister pink. I actually love thinking about Tyrion bringing her to King's Landing and giving her this pink dress, like he wants to tell everyone he loves her, but it's a handmaiden's dress to help keep her invisible because he can't actually say he loves her for reasons and plot points. She stays in that dress, or a very similar dress, episode after episode after episode, almost her entire story. The center panels do look different from one season to another, and for reasons I cannot begin to fathom, sometimes she decides to throw on this weird green jacket. But her dress, her belt, even some of her jewelry stays steady and familiar. And for me, it sets up beautifully for two of her most dramatic scenes in the series. Tyrion ends up framed for murder, and Cersei wants his head on a platter. Like a good sister, she's kind of always wanted it, but she finally gets to say it out loud. At his trial, Shae gets brought in as a witness, in the wrong dress. She is somehow upgraded to a highborn dress, actually very similar to something Sansa has worn earlier, which I think it's safe to say that Shae has wanted that through most of the series. But it's still pink. She's wearing the same belt, so I'd say it's the exact same loyal to Lannister pink. To me, it feels simultaneously wrong and right, and plays directly into the uncertainty of her taking the stand, and directly into the crush of her betraying Tyrion. She 100% out of the blue betrays him, lies on the witness stand, helps frame him, even after he looks her in the eye and asks her to stop. And when she's done speaking, at least on the first watch, I had no idea why. And she's still somehow wearing pink. One episode later, they reveal why. She is absolutely still loyal to Lannister. Just the wrong ones. These are two brilliant episodes for so many reasons. The writing, the acting, and I love the costuming choices in them. Television rarely gets to show you the interior thoughts of the characters, and I love seeing costuming hint at those thought processes. Right, I was sewing something, and I was pretty close to being finished. Just a few final touches. I added grommets to the end of the belt, which was super simple. I just took a little piece like this, stacked it on top of this little platform, sandwiched the fabric between it and this piece, then put this funny little tool on top and smashed it with a hammer! Did I not actually do it? I'm procrastinating because before you can sandwich the fabric in there, you have to cut a hole in it. And that freaks me out so much. Let's do this. Perfect! I threaded some ties to the grommets and it was ready to wear. I also tied the collar piece together with a little bit of extra cord, but the ends were aggressively unraveling. I'm not personally a tassel kind of girl, so I fixed them with these. I wrapped some thread around the ends, cut them off close to that wall of thread, dragged them down into the pretty little aglets, and sewed back and forth, back and forth, back and forth through the holes, catching the cord 100 million times until it was secure. Lastly, I'm pretty sure this dress is meant to be held in the back with a pin or a weighted disc or the belt itself, but I don't trust any of that. So I put a hook and eye in the sides of the dress to keep it shut at the small of my back. And I'm done.
Stole all my bobby pins. Thank you so much for watching. I'm actually a little nervous to post this one just because it's a little different than my usual style. So if you enjoyed listening to me ramble on and on about costumes, why don't you hit a like and leave me a comment about your favorite costume? If you didn't enjoy this, then I don't know, subscribe? Because we're doing something completely different next time. Sort of. Parts of it will still be pink.